So let's talk a little bit about the respiratory system. Remember, the respiratory system is going to be responsible for getting oxygen into the body and getting carbon dioxide out of the body. Let's start by tracing the air on its path into the body. Let's start with the mouth and nose or nasal cavity. And there the air is going to move to the pharynx. And the pharynx is a common area in the back of the throat that includes the air going into your lungs and also the food that's going down into your stomach. Then the air is going to move past the epiglottis. And the epiglottis is this little flap of tissue that goes over your trachea whenever you swallow to make sure that no food particles get down into your lungs. Then the air is going to pass what's called the larynx, and these are bands of fibrous tissue that actually vibrate and make sound as air moves past them, and you know them as your vocal cords. So what's allowing me to speak right now is that larynx. Next we have the trachea. The trachea is better known as the windpipe. This is the pipe that's going to connect the head down with the lungs. And you'll notice in this picture it's got all these little light blue sections. This is actually cartilage inside the tube that helps it stay inflated so that it doesn't collapse down. Here's where the respiratory system starts to look like an upside down tree. So you start with the trachea, like the main trunk, and then it's going to branch into two parts, the bronchi, and each branch is going to go to a right or left lung. The bronchi are then going to branch into smaller branches, eventually reaching what are called bronchioles, and each lung will have upwards of 30,000 bronchioles. So we've got a lot of surface area in those lungs. The air is then going to end in small sacs called alveoli that are found at the end of each bronchial. They look like little clusters of grapes that expand as your lungs fill with air, and we'll look at those in a little more detail in just a minute. So when you're actually taking a breath, it's controlled by a muscle called the diaphragm. And the muscle is below the lungs, and when it contracts, it's going to pull down, and that's going to cause the lungs to fill up with air. As it contracts, it pulls down and draws air into the lungs. When it relaxes, it moves back up and pushes excess air out of the lungs. So when you're breathing, it requires energy to breathe in, but breathing back out is a passive process. I'm going to show you this quick video. Here is a balloon model. We've got a pretend lung, and as she pulls down, notice the lung fills up. Breath in, breath out. Breath in, breath out. Breath in, breath out. This glove down here is acting exactly like your diaphragm. Here's a picture of the diaphragm, the lungs here, and the lung cavity. Now when this muscle contracts, it's going to pull down and fill up those lungs. The contraction is controlled by the nervous system, but it's an involuntary reaction. So your body is going to automatically contract and relax that muscle. You don't have to think about breathing. You can try and override that by not breathing, but as all parents know, eventually your involuntary nervous system takes over and you can't hold your breath forever. The control of your rate of breathing is based on a negative feedback loop related to the concentration of carbon dioxide in the blood. And this is a fairly simple and elegant system if you consider breathing rate as how fast you bring in oxygen and how fast you remove CO2. Hopefully it will make sense that using CO2 as a monitor is a good way. If CO2 is building up in your blood, that means that you're not getting rid of it fast enough, and so you need to breathe faster. If CO2 is dropping, then you don't need to breathe as quickly. So it's a really nice indicator of when you need to breathe faster or slower. I said we'd talk a little bit more about these alveoli. This is the actual site of gas exchange between the lungs and the bloodstream. We're going to use basic diffusion here to move gases from the respiratory system into the circulatory system. So this is where oxygen is dropped off and carbon dioxide is picked up. The alveoli are thin air sacs that are completely surrounded by blood vessels. Just as a sidebar, some people call them alveoli. Either pronunciation is totally fine. And if someone gives you a funny look, you just say, oh, I'm using the British pronunciation. So back to biology, having many alveoli, these little grape-like sacs, are going to give you a higher surface area for more gas exchange. If this was just one single little tube, we wouldn't have so much surface area. But because we have all these little circles here, we have lots of blood vessels around it, we can exchange lots of oxygen in just one breath and one heartbeat. Something that we find inside the alveoli is something called surfactant. And this is a liquid inside the alveoli. And it's going to do a couple things. First, it's going to help facilitate diffusion. If you think way back to when we were talking about water molecules and why water is important, one of the things it does is just bump into molecules and help move them around. And so surfactant is going to do this inside the lungs. It's going to help speed up diffusion. It's also going to keep those very, very thin sacs inflated. You guys have all experienced how plastic bags stick together at the grocery store. You sort of rub them together to get them apart and open to put your fruit in. Well, the same thing can happen here with these sacs. They're very thin, and if they collapse, they can sort of stick together. But the surfactant keeps them open. Finally, the surfactant actually has some antibiotic properties and is able to fight off any bacteria that might end up deep, deep in your lungs. Sometimes you hear about newborn babies having issues with their lungs. This is one of the last organs to develop because it's not used at all during development. The baby's getting all of its gas exchange directly through the placenta. So this is an organ that has to start working after the baby is born. Premature babies sometimes aren't ready for their lungs to be born, and they don't have the surfactant buildup to help fight infections, among other issues.